Here we're going to be sharing a pretty familiar passage of Scripture from the prophecy of Isaiah. We'll begin our reading at Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, and we're going to read the first 10 verses. We're not going to read the whole chapter, but we're going to read the first 10 verses of Isaiah chapter 6. And these 10 verses tonight will get us started, and they will carry us into the theme for tomorrow night's message as well. And I want to talk to you tonight about the urgent need for revival. The urgent need for revival. You're right, darling. Those French fries were mighty salty. God's word says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the host and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. And then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of unclean people, of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken from the tongs from off the altar. And he laid upon my mouth and said, Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. And also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and whom will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me. And he said, Go and tell this people, Hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed. Let us again pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, again, it's with humble hearts that we just bow before Thee. We just thank You, Lord, for this day. We thank You, Lord, for the joy and the pleasure of this service already. We thank You, Lord, for the presence of the Holy Spirit. We thank You, Lord, for the wonderful time of fellowship, the wonderful music, Lord, that has given glory to Thee. We thank You, Lord, now for this time, Lord, because all of it has been a precursor, Lord. All of it has been pointing, Lord, to Your Word. And so we just thank You tonight again that we've had opportunity to open Your Word and now have opportunity, Lord, together, one with another, to dig into that Word in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And Father, we just ask tonight, Lord, that You would bless us and help each and every one of us. Lord, that we may have open minds and open hearts. Lord, that we may be receptive to the message that You have for us tonight. Lord, that there may be able to be revival in Your church, Lord, not only here on this corner, but Lord, throughout this great land. Lord, may there be revival in the church, Lord, and may hearts and minds be rekindled and set on fire, and may lost souls come to know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. For that's what revival's all about, Lord, the church on fire and winning souls. Father, we ask now, Lord, as we stand at this sacred desk, may You protect us. May You strengthen us, Lord, for Thy service. Lord, may You help us to be what You would have us to be, and may we speak boldly Thy truth in a way that is pleasing to Thee. Be with us now, lead us and guide us and direct us, and we'll be ever mindful to give Jesus Christ the praise and honor and glory. For we do pray these in all things, that wonderful name's above all names, Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen and amen. Beginning tonight, as we look to the Word of God, the Bible gives us a very important fact at the very first of this text. The Bible says in verse 1, In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. In the year that King Uzziah died, it tells us something about Judah, about the history of Israel in that time. By now, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom had been torn apart, and Israel was to the north and Judah was to the south, and Uzziah was one of the northern kings, and it just so happens that Uzziah was one of those godly kings. He was a man of God. He loved God. He loved the things of God. But along the way, and as it came ever near to the end of his kingship, to the end of his leadership of the people of Judah, he was struck with leprosy, and so he had to be excluded. He had to be put out, because one with leprosy was considered ceremoniously unclean. And so in his absence, the nation began to grow weaker. The nation began to stray away from God. The nation began to fall away. The nation began to backslide. And so we can see from the very first verse that there's coming a time that there's a need for revival in Judah. There was a need for revival in Judah, because when people are falling away from God, there's a need for revival. There's a need for those home fires to be kindled. There's a need for that fire within that had spurred us and that had urged us and had pushed us along and had given us unction, that it is now down to just the spark. It needs to be set ablaze again. It needs to be jump-started. It needs to be pushed back to the front. And this was the case with Judah and Uzziah. So now he has died. He has died, and now we begin to get into the point that Isaiah wants to make here, the teaching that Isaiah wants to give us in this sixth chapter. We can see and understand from this sixth chapter that we see the formal call of Isaiah upon his life from the mighty God of heaven. And so as we look now, and we want to notice about four things very quickly this evening. The first thing that we want to notice tonight is the holiness of God. We want to notice and get fresh in our minds the holiness of God, the importance of that holiness, and the goodness of that holiness. The Bible said that Isaiah looked and he saw not only did the death of Uzziah take place, but he looked around him and he saw that the Lord was sitting upon a throne, and that was the very throne of heaven. God blessed Isaiah to see him in his throne, in his dwelling place. And so Isaiah beheld that, and he was amazed at that. And not only that, but the Bible says that he was high and lifted up, and that his train filled the temple. Folks, I want us to understand something tonight. God is holy, and God deserves to be worshipped as holy. God deserves to be praised. We need to think about God in all of His holiness tonight as the people of God, because if the people of God don't think about God in His holiness, the world sure will not. And so as we look at this text tonight, we see the picture given. The Bible says that there were those seraphims. We only see seraphims talked about here, and only in two verses. And it said above that throne, and so in other words, above the presence of God. Now let's don't get the idea that there was something above God, because that's surely not what Isaiah is revealing here. Because these seraphim, they were doing something very important. They were doing something. Well, preacher, what were they doing? They were drawing attention to God. They were drawing attention to God. Now, this is about to come early ahead of the second and third and fourth point tonight, but I want to tell you something, folks. If we're drawing attention to anything besides God in this world, then we as people, we're drawing attention to the wrong things. We need to be doing what we can as children of God to draw attention to God. These seraphim, the Bible says, they had six wings, and with two twain they covered their face, and with twain two they covered their feet, and with twain two they did fly. They flew round about that high throne. They flew round about the presence of God, giving glory to God. And we'll talk more about the specifics of that in just a moment. But they were given the glory to God as they flew round about. You remember, if you go back into the Pentateuch, the Bible teaches us of how Moses, when he met God at the burning bush, that God told him, he said, "You're in a place of holiness. Take those shoes off of your feet." The Bible said these seraphim had their feet hid from two of their wings and their faces covered. You know what, folks? Them seraphim saw and felt that there was an unworthiness, even though they were made of God, that there was an unworthiness. That I'm unworthy to stand before God save the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the only way. It's the only way. So with two, they covered their face, and with two, they covered their feet, and with two, They flew round about that throne. They flew round about that throne. And after we see that they are covered up and they have covered up their feet and that they're flying around about the throne, we notice in verse 3 now that the Bible said, and one cried unto another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory." Folks, can I tell y'all something? We are living in a sinful world tonight, but you know what? The whole world is still full of His glory. The whole world is still full of His glory, for He made the world and all that in it there is. He made you and He made me and He made us from nothing but dust. He made every animal. He made every tree. He made every blade of grass. He made every fern. He made every flower. He made every creature of the sea. God made it, and God made it at all. And might I add that God made it all well. Amen. It is good each day, He said. You never heard God in that beginning story say, "It is bad," and go back and remake it. You know, some folks are like, boy, don't get started, preacher. Some folks like to say, well, God implied it. God made a mistake to start with because all this happened, and then there was this gap that happened, and God had to start all over again. Church, I'm here to tell you tonight, God didn't make it but one time. And the reason He didn't make it but one time, praise God, is because He made it right the first time. Amen. He made it right the first time. God didn't make no junk. Let me tell y'all something else, and this won't in the notes. It's just free. The Bible also teaches us that God is not the author of confusion. And the Bible said that in the beginning, I promise it won't in the notes, but when God said, you got to let it go. Amen. God said in the beginning, He made man and He made woman, and He didn't say nothing about nothing in between. I don't find anywhere in my Bible anything but two genders, man and woman. Anything else is confusion. If it's confusion, it's of their father of the devil. Woo! Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Said, and the one cried to the other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord." You will notice there are three holies: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. One's just as holy as the other, and without the one's holiness, you ain't got none of it. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. I would point to your attention in the beginning of Genesis and in the beginning of creation, God uses the plural pronouns, we and us. In the beginning, it was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost at work. Throughout time, it was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost at work. When Joshua was getting ready to go about battle, again, God spoke in the plural. It was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost at work. Holy, holy, holy is His name. And the glory of God shines round about all over the world. Holy, holy, holy is His name. The holiness of God is taken so lightly in this world today that it is pathetic. It's pathetic, but you know what? There's a day of reckoning coming. There's a day of wrath falling a coming. There's a day when those that have rejected and have thought they had the easy street in life and thought they were going to go about their own business and doing it their own way, they're going to end up before a God of judgment, and that God of judgment is going to say, "Depart from me, I never knew ye that worketh iniquity." If a person, and by the way, before we go any further, I hope there's not a single one in the house tonight, but if it is, I want you to meet Jesus before you leave here, okay? But if a person reaches the great white throne judgment of God, it's too late for that person. There's no coming back. There's no testimony that they can offer. The judgment will be of God, and even in that, praise God, He is holy. He is holy, holy, holy. Look a little deeper in the text now. And the Bible says, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. The post pure rattled. The post-pure rattle. I remember a midnight call one time that there was a great earthquake in and around and under the jail, and the bar shook and the doors came open, and the apostles of God walked out and went to rejoicing. And I'm here to tell you tonight, folks, that the door in that place of heaven at that time, the shouting and the giving of praise to God, and holy, 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 glory to God, glory is all in this earth, that the bars pure had to shake. I wonder when it is the last time in our prayer meetings, when the last time in our worship services. I wonder when the last time in our revival meetings that it was so strong and it was so powerful. People praising the holy God of all, that the doors rattled and the windows rattled and things happened and people began to move. I wonder when was the last time. You see, not only some 27 and a half hundred years ago was there an urgent need for revival in Israel, but there's an urgent need for revival in the world today. An urgent need. As I was talking to Brother Rex about that revival a while ago, church, and by the way, I understand this. I know a little bit about geometry, and I know a little bit about counting and things like that. That sanctuary was a little smaller than this sanctuary, but that sanctuary was packed every night. It was packed. Now, by the way, I told Rex a few minutes ago when I told him that, I said, there's a pretty good crowd here tonight. Now, you folks, amen. I was just going to mess on you anyway. Y'all got to work a little bit harder by tomorrow night, because it might start tipping out of balance a little bit. Oh, boy, the church was packed. And then Rick said, you know what? She said, you're right. He said, we run meeting on through Saturday night. I do well to get my folks to attend three nights. You know? I said after the last, and I confess, I get discouraged sometimes. Amen. I told the deacons after our last revival, I said I'm not going to schedule anybody to come right now for a little while. I said, I'm just going to wait, and I'm going to see if anybody even says anything about not having revival. And we're into May now, and I usually try to schedule and have revival, a spring revival, in the latter, mid to latter part of March. Well, we're into May now. A weekend. Do you know that the first time anybody in my church, I ain't going to pick on nobody else, I'm picking on mine now. The first time that anybody in the church said anything about revival was a week and a half ago. Way past the time that we usually schedule revival. And I said, well, thank you, sis. I told her my reasoning behind it and told her we'd see about doing something in the fall. I said, and also I want you to know this. You are the first one that has said anything about it. You are the first one. People don't care about revival anymore. People don't care about getting on fire for the Lord. And preacher, you're being a little bit strong. Well, I'm not saying everybody. You folks are here. And I hope you're here because you're hungry for the gospel. I hope you're here because you're hungry for the good news. I hope you're here because you want to be enriched by the Word of God. You want to be inspired by the Word of God. You want to be excited by the Word of God. And that enriching and excitement would move you to serve God in a greater and more powerful way. Isn't that what revival is? Talked to people a number of times. Talk about, well, people getting saved. That's revival, not for people getting saved. You get folks saved in revival, that's just an extra special byproduct. Revival is for the church. Revival is to get the people in the church fired up so that where they have fallen off a little bit in this area of winning people to Christ, they get busy about getting back to the Lord's business again. That's what revival's all about. and the doors, the bars rattled. And when he cried out in the place, the whole house was filled with smoke. The whole house was moving with the presence of the Holy Spirit. The whole house was active in the work of God. There was God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Ghost present there. Holy, holy, holy. So the first thing we notice tonight is the holiness of God. The second thing we notice tonight is the awe of Isaiah. Notice the awe of Isaiah. And it didn't take Isaiah long to be in awe. It didn't take Isaiah long to realize that he was in the company of, and by the way, my wife said this wasn't a word, but I'm going to say it anyway. I stay in trouble all the time anyway. Isaiah realized very quickly that he was in the place of awesomeness. Watch what Isaiah says. He's there in this present. He said, "Then said I, woe is me." Woe upon himself is the idea, the Hebrew idea behind that word woe. Woe, the idea behind it is dead or is ruined or hurt to the depths. Woe is me. You ain't got to raise your hand, so I won't say it. You read the book of Isaiah. Man, Isaiah was a mighty man of God. He was a mighty man of God. He was a great prophet, and there's a lot of prophecy in Isaiah's book that points to Jesus Christ, that points to the events that would come in the future, some nearly 700 years, that Isaiah points to that God gave him to put down in scrolls, and he did it. He did it faithfully. And yet here Isaiah says, "Woe is me." Folks, I tell you something tonight. I stretch out and I get in my Bible. I get to studying and I get to working toward this message or that message or whatever. You know, and sometimes there are two or three kind of cobbled together. You ask your preachers to hear that, they tell you. It's very seldom that there's ever just one up there. There's several up there, and they're working to come out. And maybe they're a little more mindful than I am. But right there, it's kind of thick, and sometimes it's hard to get it all out. But you see, the Lord is working, and sometimes I'm sitting there, and I'm studying, I'm thinking about that, and I like Isaiah even more so than Isaiah. I think sometimes, woe is me. God, you can use me. God, why would you even call me? Woe is me. Folks, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay to think about the weaknesses and the shortcomings in our life. It's okay to think about the hardship, but don't dwell on it. Don't dwell on it. Give it to God. Turn to God and lay it at His feet quick. Because you see, what may be impossible for us, the Bible teaches, nothing is impossible with Him. Nothing is impossible with Him. Isaiah said, woe, woe is me. As low and as sinful as he saw himself, it was because he saw the greatness and the holiness of God. He saw the awesome God that he was blessed and fortunate enough to be in the presence of. He realized that it was a mighty God, a mighty maker who was going to call him to a great work. Woe is me, Isaiah said. He said, I am undone because I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Let me ask you something. When you got saved, maybe not that first day. Maybe not that first day or two. I had a pretty good few days. Up there on, folks like to say, cloud nine and stuff like that, I had a pretty good few first days. You know? On top of the world, you know. But did you realize after that, most likely pretty soon, you've asked Jesus into your heart, you've made that commitment, you've begun to try to walk that way, and yet it's still easy for sin to creep into your life. Woe is me. Woe is me. Would be that I could just beat it down and it could never be an issue again. But no, sin, there's a challenge. The challenge of sin every day. Every one of us face it. Let us understand tonight that if a mighty man of God like Isaiah, if a mighty man of God like the Apostle Paul, I whip myself into subjection every day. If these two could know it and experience it, then certainly we experience it as well. Woe is me. It helps us to know that we're in the presence of an awesome God. It helps us to know that I don't have to walk this journey alone. It helps us to know that how true and how wonderful the words of that song are. Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. It helps us to know that God is for us, and even though God has times of angst, and even though there's the teaching and the preaching of the wrath of God to come, it helps us to know that God is for us, not against us. And it helps us to know and to have an understanding that the Bible teaches, even the Apostle Paul, that neither principality or demon or evil or nation or government or leader or this or that or width or depth or anything else can separate us, church, from the love of God. Nothing. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Oh, he was in awe. He was in awe, and would be to God that we would be in awe. That we would walk in awe continually. That we, because we walked in awe continually, would walk in rejoicing continually. Giving all glory to God, giving all praise to God. And listen, above all things, being thankful most of all for the shed blood of Jesus Christ that covers and protects us. He was in awe. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I think along about this time, and we could debate on this a little bit if you wanted to. But I think along about that time, Isaiah was probably seeing himself. And was seeing God. Folk, I can't reach that high. I need a ladder. And then some. You know? Woe is me. Glory is he. Glory is he. Woe, I've got unclean lips. I'm amongst a people with unclean lips. And I have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. So we see the holiness of God. We see the awe of Isaiah. Thirdly, this evening, let us see for a few moments the cleansing necessary. Let us see the cleansing necessary. The Bible says, Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from off the altar, verse 7, and he laid it upon my mouth and said, Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Thy sin purged. The Nelson Study Bible says of that lump of coal, and understand this, there is no redemptive ability in the coal. It's not the coal that did it. There is no redemptive ability, but it is yet symbolic, Nelson says. It's symbolic of the efficacy of the burnt offering consumed on the altar. Now, I don't have time to go into the burnt offering and all the feast days of Israel and all like that, but I'm going to tell you this, that burnt offering was a big deal for Israel back in the day. It was a big deal. It was significant. And so that coal was brought to his lips. There's sacrifice that had been done. The sacrifice of the people didn't free them of their sin. It didn't remove them of their sin. It reminded them of their sin. And it kept their eyes ever on God. When I look to Jesus, and when I look to that empty cross, when I look to that empty tomb, I'm reminded of what Jesus has done for me and has done for you. I'm reminded of the good news of the gospel. I'm reminded of the completed work of Christ. I'm reminded of that redemptive force, you see. There's no healing specifically in the cross, but in the one who was on the cross and the blood that he shed from the cross and before the cross at the scourging post. Folks, I want us to know tonight that Isaiah got the cleansing that he needed. And when you say yes to Jesus, you get the cleansing that you need. Now, did y'all turn the air off? I might have to get my darling up in a minute to get back up there since I've got down here. Let me ask y'all something. Be careful, preacher. This is a touchy question. Did y'all take a bath today? Some of you did. Some of you probably said, well, I'm pretty good from last week, Steve. Some of you may even have said, well, it ain't that Saturday in the month yet, preacher. Now let me ask you another question. Let's say, for the sake of conversation, you took a bath today. Unless the Lord calls you home tonight, let me ask you this. Is that the last bath you'll ever need? Huh? I took a bath before I left the house, but I already feel like I'm in need of another one. You know, I am washed in the blood. And that blood, it isn't going away. As long as I don't send it, as long as I don't push it out, as long as I don't make the most unbelievable mistake that could be made to humanity, that blood is not going anywhere, but I still need a cleansing every now and then. I need a reminder every now and then. I need a touch every now and then. The Lord Jesus has just got to lay hands with me. It's got to be a good stiff shake. He's got to lay hands on us and shake us every now and then. Isn't that what revival's about? You know, he cleansed him up. He said, you clean. Watch this, because these are some sweet, that I hate it when my tongue twists up. These are some sweet words, church. Jesus didn't say it exactly this way in the New Testament. But that seraphim said this. He said, your sins are purged. Woo, y'all. You're clean. Your sin has been removed. Your lips are no longer clean. What was unworthy to even name the name of God before now? Now you can preach Him. Now you can write about Him. Now you can prophesy about Him. Now you can talk about the good news of God. And praise God, even the bad is good. Amen. It's all good news if it came from God. The Bible said all good things come from the Father of lights in heaven above. Anything good in your life, it came from God. Even many of the challenges in your life. You see, there's that cleansing that is necessary. That cleansing that sometimes is there and needed for a reminder. Not that we need a purging again, but maybe that we need a rooting out. Maybe that we need a rooting out. So it said, and it laid upon your mouth, lo, this has touched your lips, and thy sin is purged. Thy sin is purged. I'm so thankful tonight. And I'm just assuming, I'm not assuming everybody here saved, but I'm assuming some saved folk here tonight. And I'm just so thankful tonight for the day that Jesus purged that sin. For the day that Jesus purged that sin. for the day that Jesus washed us in His precious sweet blood. For the day that Jesus came into our heart and into our life and began to move and began to work and began to fill that room with the smoke of the Holy Spirit. Oh, I'm glad of that day. For every one of you here tonight, every one of you loving on the Lord, I'm so glad that He touched you. I'm so glad that maybe through you He's touched others. I'm so glad that He has touched me. I'm so glad to know that while it's true I'm not perfect, what I am in Christ is redeemed. And I am set at liberty because of that. So there was a cleansing necessary. And if there's going to be a revival in the church that's not just Cornerstone or not just Unity or not just Down East, but a revival in the church, the body of Christ, if there's going to be a reviving, there's going to be some cleansing that is necessary. Not everybody in the church is living like they ought to. So there's going to be some cleansing necessary. And God's got the answer for that. I got one last thing I want to share with you and talk a minute or two about tonight. We've looked at the holiness of God. We've looked at the awe of Isaiah. We've looked at the cleansing necessary. Finally and lastly tonight, I want us to look at the hardness of the people. I want us to look at the hardness of the people. Verse 8, Isaiah writes, "Also I heard the voice of the Lord." He ain't talking about the seraphim no more, y'all. "And also I heard the voice of the Lord. The Lord said, whom shall I send and who will go for," and there's that plural, "us. Who will go for God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost? Who will go for us?" Isaiah's just been touched. Isaiah has just gone through these few moments of awe. Isaiah's had this purging of sin, and so now God hit him at a good time. Amen. God hit him at a good time because now he's fresh, he's clean, he's fresh as a daisy, he's clean and pure as the driven snow. And God says, "Whom shall I send?" And Isaiah says, "Here I am, send me." Would there be in the church today, would there be a few more Isaiahs? Not in magnitude, not in literature, not in this and not in that, but would there be a few more Isaiahs who were willing to say, "Here am I, Lord, send me. Here am I, Lord, in whatever capacity there is, whatever little or great thing I can do, Lord, send me." So now, watch the corner turn. We've been pretty positive through these first 3 points. But look at what happens next. Look at what Isaiah writes about next. "And he," God, "and he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye, but perceive not." That phrase, "hear ye indeed," means keep on hearing. Keep on hearing. You had it under Uzziah's kingship. You had it with David. You had it with Solomon to a degree. Solomon traveled a different road, didn't he? You had it here and you had it there. Keep on hearing. Don't let it dull. Don't let it dim your ears, but keep on hearing. Man, it would be great if God could stop right there, but He didn't, did He? He didn't stop right there. Then God said, "Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed." You see, now God begins to talk about the hardness of the people. Folks, don't worry. What I'm fixing to say, don't worry about any generation but you right now. Don't worry about anybody but you and the Lord right now. But I'm just going to say this. You see, it isn't just now that folks was hard-headed about the things of God. Folks have always been hard-headed about the things of God. They will always be. The Bible has said that they would always be slow to hear. The Bible has said on a number of occasions that they were a stiff-necked people. Oh boy, the world is full of stiff-necked people. But I want to tell you, now that we have said that, now that we have made that semi-point, let's look at the big picture. If we have ever lived in a world, in a time in the history of the world, that people need to hear the gospel anymore and keep on hearing it and respond to it anymore and keep on responding to it, or yet are hardened to heart about it and not responding to it, that time is now. There's never been a greater need for the gospel in the world than it is right now today. There's never been a more urgent need than it is right now today. That's why we said the urgent need for revival in the beginning. People are stiff-necked. People are hard-headed. People are thinking that we suddenly have to talk about boys and girls with half of the alphabet. Who'd have ever thought? Without getting into politics tonight, because I don't know, I know you don't need that. But who would have ever thought that tearing down a statue, a piece of rock, would be beneficial to somebody? Who'd have ever thought? Who'd have ever thought that this, I'm still giving God the glory, who'd have ever thought that this great nation would be on the verge of turning her back on Israel? But we're there. We're there in the world that we're living in today. Folks, we need to understand that the hearts have been made fat and that the ears have been made heavy. And just like with Paul on that road to Damascus, scales have been placed before the eyes, and people are not hearing and people are not seeing. And when they are hearing and seeing, they're being hard-headed and not listening to the truth of the good news of the gospel. There's an urgent need for revival in the church today so that the people of God will be on fire about the good news of Jesus and will get out and share that good news with a lost and dying world. That need is urgent. That need is as urgent as it has ever been. And God is calling as much as He has ever called. And maybe there's just a few of us that just need our lips purged a little bit and need to be in tune with the Holy Spirit a little bit and be excited about the good news of the gospel. Amen. I want you to notice in closing, God told Isaiah at the front, they're going to be hard-headed. They're not going to want to listen. But I want you to notice something God didn't tell Isaiah. All right? Are you ready? He didn't tell him not to go anyway. He didn't tell him not to preach. He didn't tell him not to say God is holy, 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 holy. The world is full of His glory. He didn't tell us, church, He didn't tell us to not tell the world that Jesus is Lord. He didn't tell us to not tell the world that Jesus saves. That Jesus saves full and free. And that through Him and through that salvation, we can have life and we can have it more abundantly. He didn't tell us to quit preaching that good news. He didn't tell us to quit teaching that good news. He didn't tell us to quit walking that walk. But He said they're going to be hard-headed. They're going to be stiff-necked. They're going to have blinded eyes. But you go, Isaiah. You go, church, and you tell them this is what Jesus has done. Amen. This is what Jesus has done. And with that, I say, God's not through yet. Amen. How do you know, preacher? How do you know God's not through yet? I'm still here. He's not through. He just needs vessels. And there is no plan B. The church is the vessel. Amen. And amen. Father God, again, we thank you, Lord, today for your blessings. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for the truth of your word. And we thank you, Lord, for that sweet Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, for calling us, Lord, into the truth of the good news of the gospel. We thank you, Lord, for the saving grace of Jesus and the shed blood. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity as your church to be a bold witness for the cause of Christ. Father, I know that tonight this message was centered in the church. But Father, I pray, Lord, if there's been one here tonight, Lord, lost and undone without Jesus in their life that hath heard this message tonight, Lord, there's that word in there that is for them that they needed to hear. And Lord, may they be willing to say yes to Jesus before it's everlasting too late. Lord, I just ask now, Father, in these moments of decision, that you would have your will and way in all things. And Lord, that you would just minister as only you can minister. And Lord, even now we thank you. Lord, I pray, Lord, that I've pleased you tonight. But I know, Lord, that even if I hadn't, your word has been read. Thank you for its truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you got a need tonight, Jesus Christ is the answer. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. John 14:6. He's the only way. He's the only way. If you got a need within your family, if you got a concern in your neighborhood, if you got anything, if you're concerned with your nation, anything that you want to lay at the foot of the cross in this altar will be open. You come and you do that. And then lastly tonight, and finally, and I'm through, if you have the greatest need of all tonight, you've never said yes to Jesus, won't you come forward and won't you ask him to save you? Come forward and ask him to save you. And I promise you in the will and power of Jesus that he'll save you. He'll save you right now. Pastor.